You see, doctrine is not reserved for the theological seminary classroom. It should be the bread and butter of every Christian.
Christ's message is everlasting. It is the absolute foundation in our lives.
How people see and understand and relate to God is necessarily part of their worldview.
It is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word.
This special Encore presentation series reaches back into our beloved archives to messages previously aired on Living Truth. The reality is, clear biblical teaching from 5 or 10 years or decades ago remains relevant today. Popular culture may change, politics, people, economics, fashion, music, sports, media, and of course technology is perpetually transforming, but God's Word, the living truth, remains constant. We're happy to present a previously aired message from Charles Price. This is Living Truth.
I'm going to read to you tonight from 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 14 down to verse 17. Paul has left Timothy in Ephesus, where he is really serving as pastor of the church that has been established out of Paul's ministry there. And he says to him in verse 14, "As for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." I want to begin a series tonight that I'm calling Crucial Christian Convictions. That's a bit of a mouthful. But really, I want to talk about, what do we believe? Why do we believe it? And is it true? And how do we know? The writer Tim Stafford tells of a German Lutheran pastor who starts each confirmation class with a jar full of beans. He asks the young people to guess how many beans are in the jar, and then he has a big sheet of paper with their names down one side, and he writes their estimate of how many beans are in the jar against their name. Then he says, when that list is complete, "I want to do something else. I want to make another list," he says. "This time I want to make a list of your favorite songs." So they share their favorite songs, and he writes that also against their names. When the list is complete, he reveals to them the number of beans that were in the jar. And of course, they look up the list to see whose guess was the closest to the actual number. Then the pastor turns to them and says, "Now, which of these favorite songs is correct?" And of course, they protest and say, "There is no right answer to that question. A person's favorite song is purely a matter of taste." The pastor then says to them, "When you decide what to believe in terms of the Christian faith, is it more like guessing the number of beans in the jar, or like choosing your favorite song?" And he always gets the same answer. The answer he gets is, choosing what to believe is like choosing your favorite song. And so the pastor, the Lutheran pastor, says that his first task is not to confirm these young people, but to teach them that the gospel is truth. The Christian faith, you see, does not fall into the category of personal choice or preferential beliefs. It falls into the category of truth or error. It's either right or it is wrong. Now, the idea of truth has become very subjective, I guess, in our society too. People have said to me on several occasions, this may be true for you, but it's not true for me. Well, of course, there are certain things that are true for one person and not true for another. You know, if I say this is my favorite piece of music, that is a very personal, subjective statement that may be true for me, but it's not universally true. I was sitting in the lounge at home one day this week, and I put on a piece of classical music, Handel's Water Music. It's one of my favorite pieces, and Matthew came into the room and said, "What is that?" Well, actually, it's exactly what I say to him when he is playing some noisy, raucous thing that he calls music. Music is very subjective. If I say I love my wife, that is true for me. I hope it's not true for anybody else. About her, at least. It was true about your wife. But there is such a thing as objective truth. There is an exact number of beans in the jar that is not up for personal preference. That is an objective fact, and the Christian faith falls into the category of truth, objective truth. Let me read you a few statements. Psalm 25, verse 4, the psalmist says, "Guide me in your truth and teach me." Psalm 43, verse 3, "Send forth your light and your truth. Let them guide me." Psalm 119, 30, "I have chosen the way of truth." Isaiah 45, 19, "I, the Lord, speak the truth. I declare what is right." Jesus, in John 14, verse 6, embodied this when he said, "I am the truth." Ephesians 6, verse 14, Paul writes, "Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist." He describes a Roman soldier in that chapter, talks about armor. And it begins, he says, by buckling the belt of truth around your waist. And the belt was not something that held your pants up like it does here. The belt was the most important piece of equipment because everything else was attached to his belt. His shield was attached to his belt. He kept his money and his writing utensils and his compass and his weapons in his belt. They're all attached to his belt. And he says, that belt that you must wrap around yourself is a belt of truth, not a belt of preference or denomination. It's bigger than that. It's truth. 2 Peter 1, verse 12, Peter speaks of being firmly established in the truth. And Paul in Romans 1, 25 warns of those who exchange the truth of God for a lie. Not belief in God for belief in something else is not quite as good. It's truth or lie, is how Paul distinguishes. And this truth, this body of truth, is what we call Christian doctrine. Now, doctrine is a coherent body of belief where all the pieces are fitted together. Now, doctrine is important in many areas of life. A member of a political party normally subscribes to a political doctrine. That means he holds certain core things to be right, and therefore his position on lots of individual detail becomes fairly predictable because of the core doctrine, political doctrine that he holds. See, Marxism is a doctrine. It's a doctrine of a classless society that is state-controlled and everybody is totally equal. Capitalism is a doctrine, a political doctrine, which believes in private ownership and competition and the validity of profit and so on. Fascism is a doctrine of totalitarian authoritarianism. And so on. Political doctrine is the core beliefs of a political perspective on the world. The problem, perhaps, with many of us as Christians is that we often don't have a clear Christian doctrine. We have a bit over here we believe about something and something else over there and something over there, but it's not coherent. It's not part of a big picture. Sometimes we treat the Bible like a book of texts or a book of verses. Now, we're glad the Bible is divided up into chapters and verses to help us navigate our way around. But the flip side of that is that we've divided the Bible up into bite-sized pieces, and we often detach them, and we quote verses and we quote texts out of their either biblical context or out of their doctrinal context, and we give them a meaning that they may not really have if we put them back into that context. You know, William Shakespeare did not write quotations. He wrote plays. Now, there are lots of quotations because Shakespeare had this incredible way of expressing himself profoundly and majestically. But you can take a poem of Shakespeare or a statement of Shakespeare, you put it back into the play, and it has a much bigger meaning than just the quotation itself. And this big picture is vital for us to understand. We call it Christian doctrine. Paul, writing to Timothy, when he was left to pastor the church in Ephesus, in 1 Timothy 4, verse 16, says to him, "Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them." Why? Because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. He says, persevere in this doctrine. Preach the big picture and enable people to understand the big picture. And he tells why in 2 Timothy 4, verse 3. He says, "For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine." What will they do when they don't put up with sound doctrine? Instead, he says, "To suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear." What my itching ear wants to hear, that's my preference. You can put your itching ear in another direction, have your preference. Why, says Paul to Timothy? Because they were not putting up with sound doctrine. And we live in a day, of course, when information has become conveyed in sound bite size. But we actually cannot sound bite the Christian life and still be effective and satisfied in it. That's why the Church of Jesus Christ, if it's concerned with the things of God, must major on biblical exposition and biblical preaching, because we have to understand what God has said. See, truth is not found by consensus. You know, if a certain number of people agree to something, that doesn't make it true. It is found by revelation. God has revealed his truth to us. Titus was sent to Crete as pastor, and Paul wrote to him, and he said to him in Titus chapter 2 and verse 1, "You must teach what is in accord with sound doctrine." That's your teaching there, Titus. And earlier he gave to Titus the qualifications for being an elder. And he said in Titus 1 verse 9, that an elder must hold firmly to a trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. The task of an elder, he says, is to encourage by sound doctrine and be able to refute false doctrine and error. That is a task given to those who are in eldership and leadership in the church. Christian doctrine is not subjective ideas about God. It's not man's ideas about God. It's God's revelation of himself and God's ideas about man. It's in the category of how many beans are in the jar. There is a right understanding and a wrong understanding. There is truth and there is error. Now, does this matter? Isn't the all-important thing how we behave? Now, I've heard this. I've had a conversation about this. Surely, I mean, teaching is fine, but the real important thing is how we behave. And of course, that is important. That is the important thing. But why do we behave the way that we behave? Two or three years ago, Josh McDowell came here and did a seminar on Friday night and an all-day Saturday based on his book, Beyond Belief to Conviction. Some of you may have attended that seminar. And he put a pyramid on the screen. And he attributes this pyramid to a writer called Glenn Schultz. And as Josh McDowell stole it from him, I have felt at liberty to steal it from Josh McDowell. And he points out that there are, on this pyramid, certain things which are invisible and certain things which are visible. What are visible are the actions. That's, to use another metaphor, the tip of the iceberg. But underneath that, there is, at its foundation, beliefs. What a person believes to be right and true. And those beliefs cause them to develop their values, what is important and what isn't important, where do I spend my energy and where I don't spend my energy. Those are under the surface, what we believe and our values, but they express themselves in actions. But the actions do not exist in isolation. The actions are a result of what lies under the surface, below the parapet, what we believe. That's why, although our actions are very important symptoms, you know that on Judgment Day, Scripture says that the issues about which we're going to be judged are not actually our beliefs, they are our actions. I was hungry and you gave me to eat, or you did not give me to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me to drink, or you did not give me to drink. I was in prison, you visited me, or you did not visit me. I was naked, you clothed me, or you did not clothe me. Those are the ways in which, said Jesus on one occasion in Matthew's gospel, the sheep and the goats are going to be separated from each other on the basis of their behavior. But when you look at the teaching of Jesus, it's primarily about belief, not behavior. Why? Because what we believe is the cause of our behavior. If there is a disconnect between what you believe and how you behave, the reality is you don't actually believe it. If you find yourself coming into a place like this and saying, well, I'm a Christian, I'm part of a church, certain things I believe, but you behave totally differently back at home, you don't actually believe it. You may have accepted, but you don't believe it. That is, it's not the driving understanding of your life. The psalmist writes in Psalm 11, verse 3, when the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations are at fault, everything else is going to be at fault. I told this story here about 4 years ago. You've probably totally forgotten it, but I'm going to tell you again. It's a story about a multi-story building that was constructed some years ago. And it was many stories high. And several years after this building had been in operation, there appeared a hairline crack on the wall of the 42nd floor of the building. The CEO of the company that owned the building was notified, and he immediately contacted the architect and said, I need you to come. There is a crack on the 42nd floor of the building. And he asked to be notified when the architect had arrived. And after a while, he got a message saying the architect has arrived, and so the CEO took the elevator up the 42nd floor to meet him in the area where the crack had appeared. And when he got there, there was no architect, and he waited, and the architect did not arrive. And eventually he went back to his office and said, let me know when somebody finds the architect. He's in the building, but he's not on the 42nd floor. Eventually he got the word, the architect is in the 6th basement. He took the elevator down to the 6th basement. Said to the architect, what are you doing down here? I invite you to come and examine a crack on the 42nd floor. He said, you may have a crack on the 42nd floor, but that isn't your problem. Your problem is down here in the 6th basement. And what happened, apparently, according to this story, was that there was a security worker in the building who wanted to build a garage outside his home, and he hadn't got the money or the resources, so every night he took the elevator down to the 6th basement, chiseled a brick out of the wall, put it in his holdall, took it home, and added it to a growing pile in his garden. Now, it starts to sound a bit of an apocryphal story at this stage, but anyway, that's the story. And whether it's true or not, it makes a very good point, because after taking a number of bricks out of the wall, taking them home, suddenly a crack appeared on the 42nd floor. The problem was not on the 42nd floor. The problem was in the foundation. And you know, sometimes there are cracks on the 42nd floor, certainly of our society, of our own personal lives, and the issue may not be on the 42nd floor, the issue may be in the basement, in the foundation. And the psalmist says, when the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? You can intend to behave well, but you won't, because your thinking will not be informed as it should be informed. And that's why what we believe is so important to understand. I want to help over several weeks to put this foundation in place, to help us to know the big picture. And I would suggest that if you are confused about your actions, you are probably unsure of your convictions, because your convictions, your beliefs, will be the cause of your actions. If you take time to analyze some of Paul's letters, you'll find that many of them, not all of them, many of them are divided into two parts. The first part is usually doctrinal. He is teaching them, if you like, theological truth. The second part of his letter is often ethical. In other words, the first part is he's telling them, this is what you need to believe, because it's true. And then he says, second part, and this is how you need to behave. But the behavior is the result of the believing. The actions derive from the belief. And usually, somewhere in the middle of his letter, there's a great big therefore. I have a marking system in my Bible. I mark the word therefore or similar words. When you find a therefore, ask yourself, what is it there for? It's there for a very good reason. On the basis of what I've been telling you, says Paul, therefore, this is how you live. And so if you read Romans, which is Paul's probably, to my mind, greatest doctrinal treatise, because he explains there, he was writing to folks he had never met by and large in Rome, never been to Rome, saying, when I come to you, I want you to know what gospel I'm going to preach. And so he explains it. And having spent 11 chapters explaining that, in chapter 12, verse 1, he says, therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. He goes on to explain in the last chapters of Romans what presenting your body as a living sacrifice is going to mean in the way you live, the way you behave, the way you get on in society, the way you submit to authority, all these kind of things that he talks about. When Paul writes his letter to the Ephesians, there's six chapters in the letter to the Ephesians, and it splits actually evenly into three and three. In the first three chapters of Ephesians, Paul explains what it means to be united to Christ. And having been united to Christ, how he then become united to his body, to others, whether male, female, Jew, Gentile, all those old barriers have been broken down. And having explained all of that in chapter 4 and verse 1, exactly halfway through, he says, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And he then, in the next three chapters, explains what that calling is. And it becomes very practical. Colossians, similarly, the first part, he explains doctrine. And then he says in chapter 3, verse 1, since you have been raised with Christ. Here's the therefore. He doesn't use the word therefore. But since you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated. And you say, what does that mean? He tells you what that means. Now, sometimes we want to jump into the ethical section, the practical section, because we like to be practical. But we haven't understood the doctrine that makes the ethical behavior logical and natural. So if you decide, for instance, you'd like to know what Paul says about marriage, resist the temptation to jump into Ephesians chapter 5 Because we'll only understand what he says about marriage in Ephesians chapter 5 when we understood what he has said in the first part of Ephesians. We've been united to Christ, what union with Christ means. We've been united to each other, what that means. The barriers have been broken down. There's a new society. No Jew or Gentile, no slave, no free, no male, no female. That's a quotation from Galatians. But nevertheless, that's the part of the theme of Ephesians, this oneness, this union. And then he says, well, this now is how you're to live in the light of that. And he explains how you live in the church in chapter 4, first part of chapter 4, how you live in the world at large, second part of chapter 4 and first part of chapter 5, and how you function in relationships in the second part of chapter 5 and the first part of chapter 6, where he says, he prefaces this, well, submit to one another out of love for Christ. How does this work out? In marriage, in family, and in the workplace, is what he explains. And then the last section is how this works out in spiritual warfare, and he talks about that in the last part of chapter 6. But if you jump into the section on marriage in chapter 5, you won't understand what he's talking about until you understand he's saying this illustrates what it means to be united to Christ. He's the bridegroom, the church is the bride, and marriage is a picture of that. You might get some little tidbits on marriage, but you probably get it a little bit wrong. Because Paul didn't say, I'm going to write to Ephesians about marriage. I'm going to write to Ephesians about union with God, with Christ. What does that mean? It means you're united to all those who belong to Christ. Anybody that God will call his child, I must call my brother or my sister. You're united. You're one. Now then, in practical living, including marriage, how does this work? And that's why it's important that we understand in the context. Paul wrote one continuous letter. We need to understand that. And that's why it's important for those of us who do preach. If we teach a particular part, as we would in any given occasion, we must interpret the part in the light of the whole. That's why I try to be very careful if I'm teaching something like from John's Gospel, the miracles of Jesus in John, to interpret each miracle in the light of John's Gospel first, and whatever else might be in John's Gospel. And then you broaden it out to other areas, because that is the safest way. It's been said many times, a text out of context becomes a pretext. You start to build something on a text out of context that is not actually true. It becomes a pretext for something. And the safest Christian movements and the safest Christian churches have their roots firmly, I suggest you, in a systematic exposition of Scripture. That is the safest Christian church and Christian movement. Because then we understand and we form what we're doing on the basis of what God has said. And the first interest of a preacher, if I may say this to you, is not what do I want people to do. The first interest of a preacher is what do I want people to know. Because the belief is the foundation from which the actions then become almost natural. I heard a well-known preacher talking a while ago about preaching. And he said, the first thing I prepare is my conclusion. I decide what it is I want to actually accomplish. Then the second thing I prepare, he said, is my introduction. How am I going to get my congregation into this idea and thought and theme? And then he said, the third thing I do, the last thing I do, is build the bridge between the introduction and the conclusion. Well, I sat there thinking, you know, that is the exact reverse of what I do, personally. The first question I ask of a text that I'm teaching is, what is this text about? What is it saying? What is it teaching? What seems to be its message? Then if I've got time, I try to think of a conclusion. Sometimes I wing the conclusion. People have said to me before, you know, if you're the pilot of a plane, you'd fly us, you know, a nice journey, but you kind of have difficulty landing. kind of circle a lot and get very wordy at the end because I'm not quite sure how to finish this. You prepare your conclusion and introduction, you need to. But the first is, what do I want people to know from this text? My fear is, if you start with your conclusion, you actually will become manipulative of people. That's my fear of that. What do I want people to know is the first question. And you know, to live superficially is to live on the basis of behavior only. We need to live where our behavior is utterly consistent with what we believe and know to be true. In fact, it will be. That's where the mind is crucial in the Christian life. That's why when Paul, you know, in Romans 12, he says, therefore, present your bodies a living sacrifice. He talks about being transformed by the renewing of your mind. Spiritual experience, I suggest to you, begins in the mind. It begins with knowing. It begins with believing. You ever noticed how often Paul says in his writings, various of his letters, he says to people, a lot of his letters, by the way, were answering questions, of course, especially the Corinthians and so on, that they've written to him. Obviously, we don't have the original letter they wrote to him, but he picks up issues that they have obviously raised, and he's responding to them. And several times he says, do you not know? In other words, if you knew certain things, the behavioral issue would be fairly logical. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, he's talking about sexual immorality. What is appropriate sexual behavior? And he says in verse 18, you know, flee from sexual immorality. And the next verse he says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. Now he says, don't you know this? If you knew this, you wouldn't ask these questions about sexual behavior. Because you see, your behavior will be the logical result of what you believe. And don't you know that you're not your own? Your body is the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. It is not for sexual immorality. Romans 6, he says there, do you not know that we're baptized into his death? Do you not know that when Jesus Christ died in God's reckoning, you died, and therefore the power of sin is broken, because the power of sin is death. That death has already been endured by Christ as your substitute. You are in Christ. You stand before God. You have been crucified. Don't you know that, he says. If you don't know that, you'll wonder if you're forgiven sometimes. You'll wonder if you've actually broken your relationship with God, so you're no longer a Christian anymore. Don't you know you were crucified with him? His death was your death? You can say that's a theological issue. It is. Understanding the cross. We'll talk about that one day. What happened on the cross? We must understand that, because that releases us from so much more than just the consequence of our sin. He also said in Romans 6, do you not know? I'm just quoting the times that, don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are the slaves to the one whom you obey. In other words, don't you know that you fundamentally have only one choice in life? When you talk about free will, limit it to one choice that you have in life. And the choice is this: who is going to be your master? Don't you know when you submit to someone to obey, you become a slave either to sin or to righteousness? Don't you know that, he says? Romans 11, 12, don't you know what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah? Now, the context isn't important here. The point is that, don't you know your Bible? If you did, you'd know the answer to this issue. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16, do you not know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? 1 Corinthians 5, 6, do you not know that a little yeast works through the whole batch of dough? Yeast in Scripture is a picture of sin. Don't you know a little bit of yeast will work its way through the dough? Don't you know if you put a little drop of arsenic in your coffee, the whole coffee cup is poisoned? Don't you know that? So don't say, well, this is my favorite sin. I'm keeping this one. I'm going to live for God, but I'm going to keep this little sin because it's my favorite and I like it, and I don't think it does anybody harm, really. Don't you know a little yeast permeates the whole dough? James 4, 4. Do you not know that friendship with the world is hatred towards God? The point I'm making is, he is saying, if you knew certain things, your behavior would be a logical consequence of that. And that's why, although we are very concerned with our behavior, the Bible is very concerned with our ethical lives, how we behave. That is the issue on Judgment Day. In fact, on Judgment Day, the issue is not going to be, what did you believe about the second coming? Did you work that out, or were you taken by surprise? Which is a great pity if you have worked it out. It won't be an issue. The issue will be, I was hungry, etc. Did you feed me? The issue, the result is behavior. That is the result. But the cause of that behavior is that we understand, we believe, and we live on the basis of the truth that God has revealed to us. You see, doctrine is not reserved for the theological seminary classroom. It should be the bread and butter of every Christian. It is essential for Christian living. Martin Lloyd-Jones, who was a great preacher a few years ago, he made the observation that there is a rise in the need for personal counseling when there is a reduction in biblical preaching. And Lloyd-Jones used to say, I do my counseling from the pulpit, because as I teach people the Word of God, it looks after their behavioral issues. Now, of course, there are a lot of issues we need help to walk through, bear one another's burdens. I'm not in any way being negative about counseling and its value to many, many people. But I am stating, in quoting Lloyd-Jones, what I think is true. That if we understand what God has revealed. Now, I suppose the first issue to address is the issue of authority. You know, how do we know what is right? And originally, I planned to do that today, and I gave the title to this, The Authority of Scripture, but I've said so much in what was to be my introduction that I'm not going to say anything more about the authority of Scripture this week, but I will next week, because that is absolutely fundamental. Can we trust this book? Not do we like it, but can we trust it? Is it reliable? Is it authoritative? It is vital that we address that question first, because if this book is not reliable, then anything we might try to build will be like building on Jell-O. It's going to be very wobbly. If this book is true, if it is therefore authoritative, if it is in actual fact the very Word of God given to us for our understanding, then although you may be completely out of step with the rest of the world, we build firmly on its truth. And we're going to look not just at this whole question of the authority and truth of Scripture. We'll devote a whole session to that. We'll talk about the Godhead. By that I mean the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Spirit. We'll talk specifically about the person of Christ. How can he be both divine and human? For some, this may seem to be very basic, but we need to retread these paths and be sure of them. Who is the Holy Spirit? Is he an influence? Is he a person? What does he do? Who am I? What is the explanation for human behavior? Why is it that every time we turn on the news, it's bad news? What does it mean to be saved? Is it just a life belt around your waist and a rope on the other end that'll yank you safely in at the end of time? Or is salvation something much bigger than that? What is the church? You know, it says that Jesus loved the church and gave himself for the church. Not just you and me, individuals, but corporately. What is the future of the world? The Bible addresses that. How do we understand where this world is going? Now, these are some of the issues that lie at the bottom of the pyramid. And then, if we're talking about crucial Christian convictions about beliefs, we then need to have a few sessions on crucial Christian convictions about behavior. How does this work out? Paul didn't just leave it. He spent the second part of his epistle saying, this is how it's going to work out. And we need to connect the doctrines, the truths, with the behavior, the lives that we live, the actions that we perform, and find that there is a logical, coherent connection. Get your beliefs right, and your actions will be much more likely to be right. So that's the journey we're going to go on. And I hope it's a journey that will excite you, because, you know, sometimes people say, oh, that sounds very heavy. You know, just give me something, you know, with a bit of chocolate sauce on it. I wouldn't be faithful to you if I did. We'll make it as practical as we can, accessible as we can. It is accessible, but also as exciting as it is, because you'll know the truth. What happens? The truth will set you free. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that we're not fumbling around in this life, trying to make sense of it. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that as we go on this journey together, that you will help us to be excited by the truths that really do set us free, free to be the people that we're supposed to be, free to enjoy all the resources you've made available to us to live lives that are godly and fruitful and deeply satisfying. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
This message from Charles Price is part of our Encore presentation series. We've looked back into our library to select previously broadcast programs that viewers, like you, have requested over the years. The challenges we face, the tragedies and triumphs we experience, are very similar whether present day or from decades ago. Knowing that God's word is immutable, carved in stone, is comforting, and we can rest in His steadfast promise.
Every day, everywhere, there's so much clamoring for our attention. In a day where ethics and values shift and beliefs are watered down, the Bible says a time will come when men will seek their own desires and not sound doctrine. This series by Charles Price delves into core principles of biblical doctrine, offering practical suggestions for living out our faith every day.
Because what we believe is the cause of our behavior.
Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order your series, write to the address on your screen or call 1-416-222-3341. Extension 289. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Commit to sound biblical doctrine and strengthen your convictions.
What we believe largely influences our actions and behaviors. Ideas have consequences. And the way we think about God, the Bible, the world, and everything in it affects the way we will respond to it. I read a statement recently, and I'd like to read it to you, and I'd like to hear you respond to it. It says, everyone has a theology, whether they know it or not. What do you think about that statement?
I don't know. Well, no, I think it's true. People might not even know what they mean by theology, but I think we all have a worldview And I think it's really hard to be inconsistent with your worldview. And if you understand what your worldview is, it will help you understand why you do the things you do. And I think the challenge today is to help people understand what their worldview is, not just what they say they believe, but what they really, really believe. Mm-hmm. And that's really important.
My understanding of worldview is how you see the world, basically. Okay. Mm-hmm. How you see the world, and how you understand the world, and then how you relate to the world, as mm-hmm. you said in your opening quote. But specifically to your quote again, how people see and understand and relate to God mm-hmm. is necessarily part of their worldview. Even the term atheist, so people mm-hmm. who do not believe in what? Well, they don't believe in God. So still, he's part of that framework.
Right.
They have come out saying they don't believe in him, but still using the whole God idea as a frame of reference. And theology is how people understand God, how people relate to God, whether you believe in him, what you believe about him, or whether you don't believe in him at all. He's part of the whole picture.
Hmm. So what are some common concepts of God, and how do we see them lived out?
I grew up in, he's the watchmaker who made the watch and then just went off somewhere. He doesn't okay. really care about, you know, the distant God. Who's,
set time in motion.
Yeah, and it's like he's not involved in his creation, which is a kind of a fatalistic kind of thing. And he's certainly not personal. And there's a lot of people in our world who believe in God, but he's absolutely not involved in the mm-hmm. in my life. And that's really a sad view of God. And it's kind of a fatalism. You can't change anything anyways, so just do the best you can. Mm-hmm.
And I think underlying all that fatalism, there's this constant, persistent anxiety because everything's on you.
Mm-hmm.
All this heaviness of life and the world around you.
I got to make sense.
Is if God's not
interested
and active, this is all on me. Mm-hmm. And so there's this persistent, constant anxiety that gives such a heaviness of spirit because it's all on you.
Yep.
That's a heavy place to be.
Yeah. So which takes us to the middle, which I think is like the deal maker God, you know, like if you get me a wife, then I'll believe in you. Or if you get me a really good job, then I'll believe in you. And we strike these deals, and we think that God's like, tell me what you want, and I'll give you this and stuff. And that's got all kinds of problems too, as if we can do that.
I want to talk a little bit about the story that Charles Price shared in the message today about the CEO with the hairline crack on the 42nd floor of the building.
Right.
I thought it was a great story.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we remember that he calls the engineer, he comes over, he goes to meet him on the 42nd floor, only he's not there.
Yeah.
Where is he?
Yeah.
He's actually in the sixth basement.
Yeah.
And that's where they identify the problem is.
Right.
Did you like this story? Did it resonate with you? Talk to me about that.
It resonated with me as a counselor because people come and they're talking about the cracks. Mm-hmm. And it's like, no, we're not going to deal with the cracks. We're going to deal with what's happening down here. And they say, well, I thought we were going to talk about, no, we're going
right.
to. So that in counseling, that's the presenting problem.
Yes.
But the presenting problem is never actually the problem. Mm-hmm. And the problem is what's happening. So it's a great illustration. Yeah.
And I think Warwick's journey of, I mean, that's a beautiful illustration about a building, but the journey of taking people from the symptom.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Back to the source is the journey, I think, of for all of us to be able to trace a behavior that's caused pain or caused discomfort, or we've said, why would I do that? Or why am I acting this way? Back to the source of what do I believe that's making me act this way?
But it's easier to put the plaster on the 42nd floor, right? Mm-hmm. It's just like, oh, we can solve this. And you'll have lots of people who will say, oh, you don't need to go to counseling. You don't have to deal with this stuff. Just put plaster on it. Everything will be fine.
Right.
And it's like, well, it is fine for a while, actually, right? It actually looks
sometimes fine.
Sometimes it looks like, whoa.
It looks better.
It looks better.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, the whole building collapses,
to push the
metaphor. And then you think, wow, I wish I would have dealt with it back then. Then it's getting harder because the crack is actually, it's very hard to fix now. I can't put plaster on it. Mm-hmm. And it's insolvable. Fortunately, we're working in the spiritual realm, and God can heal the inner stuff. Mm-hmm. And not me, not you, God. And if there is a God, and I believe there is, but he doesn't have to show himself or prove himself to me. I've seen him heal my stuff. Not all of it, because I still got stuff, okay? I know, you find that hard to believe. But we all have stuff, and God is in that. That's what he's doing. He's healing some of the basement stuff that in our life. Yeah.
So people are totally overwhelmed because the whole building has been crumbling. Their whole life seems to be falling apart. And they come, their whole life is in shambles, and they don't have the emotional strength or resources to be able, and they're right, they don't. But when life falls apart, I believe, from what I've seen, I believe there's always a solution if they can bring the truth, if they can bring God back into the picture. Mm-hmm. There is some hope and there is a solution to what seems like an insolvable, an unsolvable life situation.
A.W. Tozer had a great quote that says, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." That's a simple way to kind of say what we started with today. There are a lot of competing ideas and subjective truths in this world, but 2 Timothy 3:16 reminds us that all Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching the truth, rebuking error, correcting faults, and giving instruction for right living, so that the person who serves God may be fully qualified and equipped to do every kind of good deed. I think it's so important.
Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
If one nation lives beyond the boundaries of Canada, then I am in duty bound to leave my country and go with the gospel of Jesus Christ to that one nation.
Highly honored that many thousands of people have tuned in to the television program.
Yusuf Mani, thank you for joining us here at the People's Church in Toronto.
Some of you will not yet be Christians. Some of you watching on television, you may have found this by accident. Don't move away. I may have the most important thing you could ever do.
Living Truth started 40 years ago, broadcasting services from the People's Church in Toronto to viewers across Canada. It has grown beyond anything imagined during those early years and now extends to every continent of the world in a variety of languages. We are entirely dependent on the gifts and support of viewers in North America to continue this ministry, and we are extremely grateful to those of you who already support us. But we need others of you to stand alongside us as well with financial support, enabling us to reach into many homes and many lives all across the world.
Living Truth reaches the world through global mission projects, a daily devotional booklet, radio, internet, as well as digital resources, CDs, and DVDs. And of course, the Living Truth television program connects viewers around the world with the gospel. Your gift of $5 brings the message of Jesus Christ into one home. A gift of $100 reaches 20 homes. Whether you give $5, $5,000, or more, every gift brings the Living Truth to those hungry to grow in Christ.
Thank you for supporting the ministry of Living Truth and for being part of our diverse family. Though the languages and the cultures in which we broadcast are all different, the truth of the Word of God is universal and unchanging.
Please help us to continue reaching the world with His message of salvation by making your gift today. God bless you.
There's an adage that says, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Or how about, the only thing constant is change? Our Encore presentation series reminds us that although times change, clear biblical teaching addresses the issues of the day, past or present. We're also reminded that Christ's message is everlasting. It is the absolute foundation in our lives, and His promise of salvation will never change.
Join us next time for more clear biblical teaching here on Living Truth.
To watch this message again, visit our website, download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube.
Join us next week for part two of this three-part encore series by Charles Price. This is Living Truth.
It is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the Savior.